All right, we'll go ahead and get started. I'm Matt Siegel, Chair of the Science Advisory Committee here at the Cobb Institute, and I'm very excited for our second session of Intuiting Life. Today we have three speakers who will be summarizing their chapters from our book, Process Philosophical Perspectives on Biology. Last time we had Spiridon and Federico summarizing their chapters, a very interesting discussion, and we could have gone on, I think, for another several hours. There were wonderful questions. So let's get right to it. I'm going to introduce our first author, Philip Tryon. Philip did his graduate work in physics at the University of Wisconsin, and subsequently worked as a development engineer on early automation projects for a company named Biotech. He has a lifelong interest in quantum mechanics and how it relates organic systems and informs biological science. Very eager to hear about your chapter, Philip, which of course I have already read, but it's great to have you here to explain it to us. So the floor is yours.
I'd like to thank everybody that made this forum possible. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'd like to welcome all of our viewers today. Today, I will be speaking about physical changes in the universe and the coming into being of form and pattern. If a seed is placed in the soil, a plant grows, the form of the plant emerges, and the universe is changed. In particular, I would like to focus on emerging patterns that recur, that repeat. So if I drop a second seed into the soil, another plant emerges. It looks like the first one. And this is a recurring pattern of coming into being of form. I just share my first slide. I promise I won't read this to you, but it's a list that shows a few examples of these recurring processes of coming into being of form. Each one is connected with a certain type of organism. And these patterns are ubiquitous. Most everything that an organism does can be seen as a recurring inherited process of coming into being a form. I think one would be hard-pressed to think of anything that a bacterium or a spider or a mosquito does that is not essentially an inherited pattern of behavior. Now, a few things to notice about these patterns. Number one is they've all evolved to their present state, presumably through a long series of iterations, and they will continue to evolve. Also, all of these processes tend to be goal-directed. There's a flatworm called a planaria. If its head is severed, it will regenerate its head. This is a goal-directed recurring process that begins when the head is severed and comes to an end when the head is fully formed. Now, I'd like to make two explicit assumptions about these recurring patterns. Number one, they cannot be accounted for by any model based on mechanism. And a second related assumption is that these patterns are not stored as programs in the genes, and they're not encoded in the DNA. Now, I could argue for these assumptions, but many other people have already done that, including some of the other authors that have contributed to this volume. So how does one account for these recurring processes without leaning on the computer analogy? That is what my chapter is about, and that's what I'll be speaking to you about today. It seems that in order to account for these recurring processes, we're going to have to start at the basic, fundamental, or ontological level. As I've already said, a mechanistic ontology, which assumes the universe at its fundamental level is composed of distributed matter moved around by universal forces, is not going to be sufficient. So another attractive candidate as for an ontology is to assume that the universe at its basic level is composed of events, individual instances of coming into being of form. So under an event ontology, the universe is composed of all events. Okay, so this This diagram is intended to illustrate events as processes of coming into being a form. In the upper schematic, we have a representation of a quantum mechanics, which is supportive of this event ontology. Each of the red stars signifies an event, an instance of coming into being a form, which in quantum mechanics is referred to as a measurement interaction, because for these quantum systems, like an electron or an atom, the scientist chooses a measurement apparatus and then makes the measurement. After the measurement is made and facts about the state of the system are established, there's an ensuing period of potentiality or uncertainty in which many potential states coexist, none of them being established until a subsequent measurement is made, at which point there's a transition from potentiality to actuality, and one state becomes established out of the many possibilities. Now, as a series of these measurement interactions occurs, presumably a trajectory forms for the physical system through space and time. A couple of things to notice about this schematic. First of all, I speak of constrained potentiality because all of the potential states are limited by the laws of nature. They must all conform to natural laws, laws of physics. So if the system being measured were a locomotive and it was found to be traveling 100 miles an hour, none of the potential states would find the locomotive at rest because this would violate the conservation of momentum. Also, the transition from potentiality to actuality that occurs at the time of a measurement is seen to happen instantaneously, or at least very, very fast. According to quantum mechanics, the outcome state is selected randomly from among the possibilities. Now I'd like you to turn your attention to the bottom schematic. Here we have a very simple representation of Whitehead's view of an event or a process of coming into being a form. Again, we start with facts being established. He refers to this as a concrescence. There is then a developing period of potentiality, which he refers to as the physical pole. Eventually, an interaction is initiated, the presence of an organism, and there's a disprehension ends in another concrescence. So these are relatively similar. One thing to notice is that in each of these processes or events, there's a required presence of an entity. In the case of quantum mechanics, there's a measurer who chooses the apparatus and makes the measurement. In the quantum mechanic, in the Whiteheadian case, there is an entity, which I will speak more about. So I'd like to take a closer look at this period of prehension and break it down. I can. All right. So prehension, an interactive experience. The entity is present. There's a sensing and perceiving of conditions. There is a development of an experience of feelings, ingressions of eternal objects. There's a connection with an influence from past events, perhaps an evaluation of opportunity and liability. Inclinations develop. And then the outcome is facilitated and new facts are established. The many possibilities become the one actuality. One thing to notice here is that the outcome is not independent of the inclinations, so that we see a hint of agency where the inclinations and feelings of the organism may contribute to and influence the outcome. Now, let's get back to thinking about these recurring processes of coming into being a form that are made up now of a series of events under an event ontology. I think we can say that the entity must be informed as to this process or how to achieve this goal-directed process. It must have the know-how in terms of trying to achieve this goal, and even what goal is worth achieving at a certain point in time. So where could this know-how have come from? Well, the entity is sensing and perceiving, so it knows something about present conditions. There are eternal objects that may come into play. But essentially, the entity must be informed from the past, from past events. So it must be informed through its connection with and influence from past events. All right, I've been speaking about recurring, evolving, inherited, goal-directed patterns of coordinated physical movement produced or embodied by certain individual organisms. And this is not a very efficient way to talk about this phenomena. So I'd like to just cut to the chase and call these recurring patterns the habits of nature, understanding that each one is connected to a particular type of organism. Now, bringing up this this word habits, no doubt you, many of you realize that I'm invoking some of the insights of Rupert Sheldrake, his formative causation. He hypothesizes that the universe is naturally a habit-forming realm where organisms naturally form habits. These habits are formed by a series of similar iterations. He talks about a morphic field consisting of past events, where an organism will tune into the morphic field and be guided by the morphic field as it embodies recurring patterns or habits. At this point, I'd like to go back to this slide and see how Sheldrake's formative causation might be merged with Whitehead's idea of prehension. We've already seen that an entity is informed by past events. So it could be that an entity, as it embodies a habit, is being guided by the morphic field and being influenced through its connections with past similar individuals performing similar tasks. For example, a spider spinning a characteristic web would be connected with and influenced primarily by incidents in the past where similar spiders were spinning similar webs. And in fact, the spider today spinning a web would be involved in a resonance with all past events in which spiders were spinning similar webs. So this resonance would be essentially with past events which were involved in forming the habitual pattern. All of those events would be the ones that it was most connected with. So at this point, I'd like to take a step back and think about the bigger picture here and go back to this slide of quantum mechanics. Now, a little bit over 100 years ago, technology was developed that allowed scientists to probe tiny quantum systems like atoms and electrons and make measurements on them. And they quickly realized that classical physics, the mathematics of classical physics were inappropriate for quantum systems. So they were forced to develop a different mathematical approach to describe these tiny systems, and that is what quantum mechanics is. This schematic is a representation of the ideas, or at least one interpretation of this mathematical formulation. And quantum mechanics has proved itself to be very reliable over time. In fact, it's pretty much agreed that quantum mechanics applies to all physical systems in the universe, regardless of size, even though for macroscopic systems, the equations are not going to be solved because of the complexity involved. But since the mathematical formulation applies to macroscopic systems, we might speculate that the insights displayed in this schematic might also apply to macroscopic systems. So an organism, as it experiences and makes a measurement of its surroundings, might be initiating transition from potentiality, constrained potentiality, to actuality. Think of a deer stepping into a meadow using its measuring apparatus, maybe its eyes or ears or nose, and trying to determine whether it's safe to graze in the meadow. Well, the deer would not only be initiating transitions to actuality, but it might not only be experiencing, but it might be initiating transactions from potentiality to actuality, thereby helping to create the developing universe. Now, this model is further informed by Whitehead's idea of prehension, because an organism having an experience initiating transition from potentiality to actuality might actually be influencing the outcomes of events along the way. So what we are left with is a universe where organisms embodying characteristic habits are co-creating the universe through their experiences. Now, I haven't spoken about the timing between events here, between successive events. I'd like to do that now. The surface of our planet Earth is rife with organisms. There are a lot of organisms having experiences and possibly creating transitions from potentiality to actuality. The density of life indicates that the speed is probably very fast here, that the time between events is very short, certainly shorter than the reaction times of human beings. And in addition to that, the intensity of experiences tends to be relatively high here. Think of a lion chasing a wildebeest. This is a pretty intense experience. There are other parts of the universe where experiences might not be so intense or so closely spaced. Think about interstellar dust or the interior of planets or moons. Here, the spacing between events might be a lot longer. And in these situations, the physical systems might endure in potentiality for, you know, quite long periods of time, as opposed to the surface of the planet where things happen very, very quickly. So this model is creating a view of the universe as a place where organisms are co-creating the universe by embodying habits, but we know that habit embodiment is essentially an unconscious process. This does not require consciousness to embody habits, but most of us realize that consciousness does exist. So how could we get consciousness out of the habitual world? And I would suggest we think about a process of improvisation. Anytime that a habit is being embodied, the likelihood of success can be increased through skillful improvisation on the basic structure of the habit. So it seems likely that natural selection would favor an ability to improvise on the basic pattern. If a cheetah were chasing a gazelle, it would do a lot better, perhaps, if it was able to adjust its chase based on the reactions of prey. So natural selection resulting in an increasing ability to improvise, at least among certain organisms, might lead to an ability for reflection in the course of an event. In other words, the organism might have space to consider which choices might lead to which outcomes, which might be most favorable. It might even invoke past experiences in order to reflect on appropriate actions. An increasing ability for reflection might lead to the possibility of what we think of as free will, where the organism would be responsible for its choices since it had an ability to reflect on them. And it's only a short step from free will, I believe, to a budding consciousness, at least among some organisms. Now, this model that I'm sketching for you today is a synthesis of quantum mechanics, some of the insights of Alfred North Whitehead, and Sheldrake's formative causation. It does not point to the fact that mechanism is wrong or incorrect, only that mechanism applies to a limited sphere in which there are no organisms present with feelings or inclinations that affect outcomes, like in a machine. mechanism is good for describing machines. Just as relativity, which applies to the general case of all systems of movement in the universe, reduces to classical treatment under conditions where speeds are slower, so it is that the organic model that I'm presenting today would reduce to a mechanistic model whenever there are no organisms present with feelings that matter. At this point, I'd like to recognize a few ways that this model is different from Whitehead's organic philosophy. And the main difference has to do with the entities involved. Whitehead's entities tend to be transitory and amorphous. They're not enduring subjects, and neither are they necessarily embodied. In fact, there's no one-to-one correspondence between Whitehead's entities and actual living organisms. In the case that I'm making today, the entities are organisms. They are embodied. They develop a history of experiences from which they may learn. They may develop their own individual habits or even idiosyncratic versions of their inherited habits. Being embodied is significant because the body, the structural body, the configuration of an organism is the vehicle which connects it appropriately to the morphic field. So that a fox embodying a certain pattern or habit finds itself connecting with and resonating with past events involving foxes, not squirrels and not chickens, but foxes because of its body. Additionally, each organism, or most organisms, some organisms, are endowed with DNA, which has a structure, a specific structure. So the DNA might serve as a refinement of the antenna, if you will, of the organism that allows it to tune in more specifically with ancestors in its own family line, its own family lineage. I'm going to finish today by pointing out a few ways that this model changes our view of the universe and specifically of biology. According to modern biology, what is evolving in the universe are species. Each species has a trajectory of evolution. But according to the model that I'm suggesting, it is individual habits that have a trajectory of evolution, that habits are the things that are actually evolving, not species. And this explains a lot of evidence that's difficult to explain if it's species that are evolving. First of all, these habits might be shared between different organisms. Think of a viceroy and a monarch butterfly. They have the same patterns. They're tuning into the same habits, but they have different DNA. They're different species. Also, anyone familiar with recent finds in the archaeology of human ancestry will recognize the fact that there have been a number of discoveries of hominids, ancestors of modern humans, that display some surprising characteristics. In fact, it's very common for them to be a combination of modern features and some very archaic features too, which is, it's a stunning thing. But if it's habits that are evolving, this is not so surprising. Atavism, the appearance of archaic features, would be expected because habits once developed would continue to persist. When we were children, we used to play a game called Mr. Potato Head. I don't know if any of you have ever played it, but you take a potato, and the game consists of taking different pairs of eyes and ears and noses and mouths and sticking them on the potato to make a face. And I think that this is what comes to my mind when I think about these hominids. They're like collections of features that don't necessarily go together. And it's a mix and match situation, which is suggested by the evolution of habits. Also, this model changes our view of what an organism actually is. According to this model, an organism is not only an entity that experiences the world, and by doing so, initiates transition from potentiality to actuality, and sometimes influencing those transitions. It's also an entity that embodies inherited recurring characteristics and patterns. So, in addition to plants and animals being organisms, we might think of cells as organisms, a skin cell or a blood cell. In fact, even DNA molecules might be seen as organisms here because they're embodying ancestral habits. They're embodying patterns of producing certain proteins. They're even seen to be involved in self-repair. So this indicates they might be organisms. Even protein molecules could be conceived as organisms because of the habitual folding pattern they have inherited from their ancestors. We might even go so far as to think of atoms as organisms, as they embody patterns that were present in previous similar atoms. Now, I'm not saying that every atom is having intense experiences, but maybe sometimes they do. A carbon atom on a microscope slide is probably a very inert entity, whereas a carbon atom in a seed on a warm, wet spring day might actually be active in contributing to the germination of the seed. At the other end of the spectrum, we might consider whether Gaia, our own planet, is an organism that experiences. And it might well be so if there are enough pre-existing similar planets to have developed tendencies and habits that are being embodied by our own planet and guiding the development of our own planet. I could say more, but my time is running short, and I think I will leave it there. One final thing. If anybody's interested in communicating with me about these ideas, I am going to share my email with you for a second here, so you can, because otherwise it might be hard to reach me. And I want to thank you very much for your attention. I really appreciate the opportunity to present a summation of my chapter to you today.
Thank you so much, Philip. A lot to chew on and digest there. And so next up, Johanna Heusler will be presenting her chapter to us. Johanna studied biology and philosophy in Munich and works at the LMU in science communication. She currently is working on her PhD in philosophy. About the problem of free will, arguing for a libertarian account of freedom in a broadly white Hegelian spirit. Her philosophical interests cover a wide range of topics, including philosophy of mind, the problem of free will, the philosophy of science, theories of causality, the philosophy of biology, as well as classical metaphysics. Thanks for joining us today, Johanna. Go ahead and share your slides, and I look forward to hearing your thoughts.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Matt. So the chapter, or my chapter, in the book was basically about physicalism and an account to challenge physicalism, and also to think about an idea of a concept of agency that already handles agency at the very base level of organism. So I would call that organismic agency. And usually, if you look into accounts in philosophy of biology, an agency is conceived as something like an organism that is able to act on an environment and is able to change that environment therewith. So a prerequisite for that account is a differentiation between organism and environment. So organisms do actively set its own boundaries. And I'm arguing in that way for an account of agency that might be conceived already at a more primitive level, namely the organism itself and its self-maintenance, which is also conceived, especially within a Wittgenstein scheme, as an active, purposeful, and normative process. And it comes in pretty nice if you have already this kind of basal level of agency or vividness, we could also call it, because then we have a very good basis to also think higher level varieties of agency within a continuity from this very basic. So to the concept of organism, organism is within the philosophy of biology and mostly coming from Kant, still seen as a strongly specialized in order structure. Hans Jonas was very famous for postulating a form over matter principle. And that means that an organism has this kind of ability to maintain itself continuously, and it has there is it contains its own form by bringing forth by bringing forth its own parts. So an organism is not only organization, but it is a continuous maintenance of that organization. And it is there with a continual flow of energy and matter that corresponds to what we would call in biology anabolic and catabolic processes, which both changes but also maintains that organism. And that's actually a structure that is very unique for the living within the world, and we don't find it anywhere else, I would argue. Higher animals, as I already said, but also some smaller lower animals like bacteria, would have the ability to move in the environment. So they change them by acting upon the environment. And we can also see this form of acting upon the environment as a form of self-organization, because if we conceive it from the perspective of organismic processes, it would be just a specialized form of self-maintenance. So the organismic processes are then not only directed to the stability of a certain process that consists the organismic form, but are furthermore special, like directed at a specialized condition of that form. So for example, a Venus flytrap or plant that is closed and has a fly within the trap is in another form condition than an open Venus flytrap. And in that way, we might conceive organisms as primitive agents. They act in a way on their own processes, and there is guarantee its own persistence. So every instance of acting on the environment is mediated by organismic metabolic processes, and every kind of metabolic processes is in some way or another directed to maintain the organism as a whole. So as already mentioned a little bit, we have different degrees of abilities within the picture. And the most base level would be this continuity of self-maintenance, which we could also call like a form of metabolic self-acting ability, or easier seen vitality. Then we have this ability of the whole room, whole space of organisms to be able to act on the environment. And this is also already to be perceived as something that is purposeful. And there is not easy to reduce to natural sciences, as we show in a second. And the third degree of rational acting within what is traditionally within the philosophy of agency perceived as a form of acting. And that is the acting with rational aims after those aims are set. And now if we have human rational acting, then we need as prerequisites the other degrees of attentional abilities. So two needs one, and three needs two and one, so to say. So from a physicalist standpoint, and we have to reduce this kind of abilities to kind of mechanistic framework or law-like behavior that can be in a broad way grasped by physics. So the idea behind physicalism, of course, is to grant for a continuity between the living and the non-living. And I would say this is not a bad thing. But this reducing of life doesn't work very good. So in a physicalist worldview, everything that cannot be grasped by physics on its own, which would be, I have here eyes, brains, a whole organism, so everything that supervenes, so to say, on the base level of physics, usually seen as quantum mechanics or particle physics, has to be conceived as derivative. And it doesn't have any causal power on its own. So every higher level causal power comes completely from this lower level happenings. The organism is then also structured bottom up with regards to this ontological level. So everything that is beyond that ontological basal level, so for example, particle physics, is only a matter of description at the end. So we might describe something like an organismic arrangement as a complex arrangement, as if it had aims, or as if it would be living. But at the end, it is all conceived, or it's all defined by the spatial efficient causality. And that's also true then for all forms of organismic phenomena, and physicalist accounts, and then need to overcome the cleft between this law-like and at the end blind to aims behavior and the meaningful and aim-oriented, goal-oriented behavior of living systems. So modern physics offers some understanding of that, or of that idea to close that gap. And that would be a reference to something like a non-equilibrium thermodynamics. And this description enables an explanation on how organisms might be capable to maintain the highly ordered structure. The common models that is much discussed within philosophy of biology in that discourse are dissipative systems. And dissipative systems are characterized both temporarily by maintaining a specific non-equilibrium and highly ordered state while they are consuming a certain energy credit. So this is only physical systems. And during the persistence of that energy flow, those systems are relatively stable, or they are stable and have a stable form element. And as far as soon as the gradient is consumed, they will decay. And the idea within philosophy of biology is then to transfer this model to a living system by conceptualizing living systems in analogy to such dissipative systems. Living systems then, of course, would not only be able to maintain the structure for the cost of energy, but also to continuously refill their own energy supply by the consumption of nutrients at the end. So the key property for the reduction of concepts like teleology or aims becomes this non-equilibrium state of such systems, which is then actively maintained. And the development and maintenance of organismic life remains still blind in the very sense of efficient causality, with its processes just happening. So on the very basics, of nature. This happening is just happening by efficient causality, but then on a systematic view, it looks as it would be seemingly ordered in a kind of teleological way. So this non-equilibrium state, the organism itself with its form elements, would continuously maintain itself. And in that way, an organismic system is in the system theoretical sense functionally closed. The system is closed because each and every component of that system contributes to its maintenance. It builds up the organism, and the components are functional insofar as they are maintaining the system. So they are directed, so to say, towards the system's maintenance. And that's actually a very Kantian concept. So we would have two different senses of aim or teleology, because the function components have the aim, so to say, to maintain the organism, and the organism would have something like the aim to maintain itself. And the functionality of those components comes from the organizational embedding. So it stays at the end still, this idea of aims or reasons have to be conceptualized in an ontological way as secondary to this basal physicalist worldview, as the causality involved is still only defined by efficient causality, which generates the specific organization of the organism in the first place, and also each and every movement of that organism within its environment. So, on the one hand side, those system theoretical accounts of organisms are very close to anti-reductionist conceptions of organisms, for example, Hans Jonas concepts. And they are still based on a physicalist conception. And that, of course, makes them very interesting within a physicalist worldview. The critique, however, would be that a proper comprehension of such rich concepts of as normativity or agency with respect to the fundamental basis of reductionist accounts is not possible, because we have still a mere blind to aim system. And we can see that pretty clearly if we think about a model of the origins of life as it is proposed by Stuart Kaufman. And that's a really interesting model where he tries to model a phase transition from random catalytic molecules to a collective autocatalytic networks. And the idea is that an organism is something like an autocatalytic network, because an organism is a structure, organizational structure, in which each and every component is composed by the system as a whole. So an autocatalytic system has a very similar structure, or actually the same kind of structure. And the basic idea would be now that within a highly diverse pool of different catalytic molecules, with that pool being big enough, there will always be one molecule that catalyzes the synthesis of another one, so that at the end, each molecule would be catalyzed within this network. And within, given a certain critical diversity, we would have a phase transition from just this random catalytic networks to an interconnected autocatalytic network, which with its components catalyzing each other. And such an autocatalytic system might be able to evolve. It might be answering to nutrient supply changes and so on. So it has a structural similarity to an organism. And now my remark to that is that random catalytic processes are obviously not functional, and nobody would call them functional. So using this term functionality with regards to an equally random autocatalytic network, or even claiming that this random network is normative, seems not only unnatural, But it's also wrong because it's still just blind happening, which is, and that is the thing, which is by chance autocatalytic. So nowhere comes there something in like real aims or a real teleology. And within this kind of model from the beginning of life, there's no categorical difference between the model of a simple autocatalytic network and the model of a complex-based organism based on system theoretical theory. So the organization is fully defined by its grounding in matter and not vice versa. So the form over matter principle proposed by Hans Jonas would be on an ontological level grounded still by a matter over form principle. And therewith the form over matter principle, which is in modern philosophy of biology, one of the most important arguments, melts away with regards to the ontological framework of a pure physicalism. So this as-if perspective is not enough to sufficiently explain all aspects of life, and it might explain why biologists are still allowed to attribute to their subjects things like aims or teleology. But this is a mere heuristic perspective at the end. So we as humans have to conceptualize ourselves within a deeply rational and normative context. And that's not only true for every different field of cultural life that relies on normative categories, be it moral or legal responsibility. That's also discussed, of course, in the free will debates very intensively. But it's also true for physicalist theory and the natural sciences themselves. So those theories firstly claim something like truth for their own concept and for their own self-conception. And also they depend on the in principle validity of empirical sciences. And within empirical sciences, we also have a context of agency. And this context of agency implies a reliance, heavily reliance on norms and on rationality, which is a necessary condition for empirical data and for theorizing. So scientific theories that are based on human purposefulness and therefore cannot negate this purpose. And they also can't be reduced to an as-if perspective, which is itself based on that theory. So if we take that argument seriously, we would have two possibilities. One might either sacrifice the aspect of continuity within the evolution of life, thereby categorically separating human rationality and normativity from the rest of the living world. And that's a way that was gone, for example, by Descartes famously, or dualist accounts, and also, I would say, by Kant. Or one might include a non-reductive concept of normativity already in the very basis of life, thereby supporting a substantial concept of life as it has been initially introduced. And of course, Whitehead is one way to go to that second alternative, as he integrates the aspect of continuity between non-life and life, as well as the discontinuity. And he can also grant for a gradual evolvement of agency and of the vitality within life. So I think it's a very nice fundament of the philosophy of biology. And I will also show, just for the summary, a little bit of Whitehead's own strategy for a conception of organism. So Whitehead, in his process and reality, has two different strategies, or talks about two different strategies to maintain order in response to novelty accompanying an ever-changing environment. And those are the aspect of continuity continuity and an aspect of discontinuity. So on the side of continuity, we do have a kind of ordered structure that can be maintained by inheritance of its main characteristic over time. So that is the idea of the negation of differences and of the inheritance of a form element. And by repetition and reproduction over time. And then there's another kind of strategy to maintain order, and that is the concept of discontinuity. And in discontinuity, there's a form of stabilization of order by seeking of complexity. And that one relates more than the first one to an teleological aspect and to the concept of vitality. So the concept of vitality, again, includes two different aspects. The one would be an active momentum. So it constitutes a kind of self-relational structure as a necessary condition for an organism to maintain itself continuously over time. And the other would be something like conceptual prehension, which can be seen as a kind of strong teleological moment. On a very primitive level, we can perceive this conceptual apprehension as a form of harmonization. For example, the relation of the organism to its environment needs a continuously harmonization of the metabolic structure of that organism, so to maintain its form within an ever-changing environment. And on higher levels of human minds, we might also think about conceptual thinking in that case, of course. So those two options of maintaining order are both fundamental prerequisites of life. To the first option, each and every living being needs a solid structure, so to say, a material basis. And that is what biological sciences are also in search for when they're searching for dispositions or like the mechanisms of life. Biological sciences, of course, are methodologically restricted to the aspect of efficient causality because they only can search for something that is stable over time and that reproduces itself. Within a stable set of starting conditions, a biological component, for example, something like a biomolecule or a bacterial cell, will interact in a certain and repeatable way. So the reaction of the system is not dependent on anything other than the types of molecules or cells involved and of the starting conditions. And that's an important point because the aspect of continuity thus depends on the maintenance of the milieu within the organisms, which is the starting conditions for the biomolecules in vivo. Dependent on the overall structure and the maintenance of the structure within a changing environment. So this self-maintenance requires the aspect of discontinuity and change too. An organism can only maintain the dynamics of its body by continuously and actively striving to an ideal of harmony. And we can also conceive that as means to end relationship, as we can conceive the organismic causal framework as becoming a means to establishing and continuously harmonizing the overall complexity of that organism, and for Whitehead to seek for a maximum intensity of experiences. So as it's commonly known, Whitehead's philosophy is based on a metaphysics in which all reality is conceived or consists of actual entities, which are bipolar. They have a physical and a mental pole. And those poles constitute two aspects of one active process, one causal process, and are both required to conceptualize any process at all. So on the level of particular processes, life and non-life are a matter of degree rather than of categorical differences. So for our strategies of order, the first order option of order emphasizes the physical pole, which has this domination of causal inheritance and stability in order and is directed to the past. If a nexus transmits a common element of form diachronically from one actual entity to the next, the parallel series of processes are built to stable objects. like macromolecules, DNA, electrons, stones, teeth, and so on. But one can also conceptualize hierarchical complex organizations and process series embedded in varying environments. So the mechanistic framework of an organism, so that which is also a subject to the biological research, would be a hierarchical and complex organization of certain very differentiated processes. Macromolecules are built up from atoms and are in turn themselves material form the cellular system and so on. So they are target of life sciences, as I already mentioned. And a biologist, and that is an interesting fact, must treat her subject as if it was completely describable by efficient causality. So the as if aspect is also be targeted to efficient causality. And following Whitehead, those descriptions have to be considered as mere abstractions. Even the basal elements of his cosmology are richer than a pure mechanistic sequence of occurrences, as they contain a teleological element, and there is the possibility of evolution of higher forms of inwardness. Coming to the second order again. So the second option of order can be conceived or can be seen as being integrated within the living by terms of what Whitehead calls an entirely living nexus. That is a series of processes that implements the aspect of discontinuity and allows for the maintenance of stability and order of an organism as a whole. It serves as an integration point for the multiplicity of organismic processes. So this structure enables a proper comprehension of the organism as agent. The intrinsic causality predominated by the aspect of final causality would be a great variety of possible responses to a changing environment. And this entire living nexus, the teleological moment of the organism as a whole, dominates the organismic processes and is able to harmonize them. So all the processes are striving then towards that harmonization ideal that's implemented within the entirely living nexus. But the entirely living nexus is also opposed to the spatial mechanistic framework, as in the intrinsic tension that characterizes each and every actual location becomes within the organism, displayed once again within the structure of each and every living being. So the mechanistic framework is directed towards the unity of the organism, and the concept of functionality comes there naturally. The cellular processes are functional towards the maintenance of the organism insofar they are influenced on their teleological focus through the entirely living nexus. And that allows for a really nice metaphysical concept of agency. The first aspect of order would mean that the organism depends on cellular and physical processes with a dispositional aspect of continuity, and that's the one that is measurable by biological sciences. And the second aspect of order gives rise to the idea of the organism itself as acting on its processes, of controlling those processes within a highly dynamic organization, which requires a kind of active feedback loop, the entire living nexus. The organism can be conceived as a unit and as both self-referential and self-active, active and acting. The organism actively maintains itself. On the lowest level, that was the first level of agency I was introducing in the beginning. The special activity enables the continuity and harmony of the specific organization. Higher organisms, the second aspect of agency, strive to act and survive within a changing environment. The entire living nexus integrates complex information, which includes setting certain aims and having them implemented by means of those spatial processes. And the third aspect of agency would be human rational agency, where the entire living nexus is highly developed and has the ability to think conceptually as well as to explain aims, for example, within the natural sciences. Yes. So thank you a lot. That was a summary of my chapter.
Thank you, Johanna. That was quite in-depth and important contribution to this discussion. I'm reminded of one of Whitehead's quips from Function of Reason, where he says that scientists animated by the purpose of proving that they are purposeless constitute an interesting subject for study.
I have that actually within the article because it's so nice.
Yes, it's quite funny. But a very serious issue that doesn't seem to be noticed. So we're going to move along now to our final panelist today, Nathaniel Barrett, who is a research fellow and member of the Mind-Brain group at the Institute for Culture and Society in Spain. The main focus of Nathaniel's research is the nature of value and its role in experience, mind, and life, especially as examined from the perspectives of pragmatism, process philosophy, and ecological psychology. His recently published book titled Enjoyment as Enriched Experience, published with Palgrave this year, draws on the philosophies of John Dewey and Whitehead and recent scientific research to develop a theory of affect as the enrichment or deterioration of conscious activity. Thanks so much for joining us, Nathaniel. I look forward to hearing your chapter summary. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Matt. Well, first of all, thanks to Matt and Richard and the folks at the Cobb Institute for providing this forum. And also, I want to say thank you and congratulations to Arthur and Spiridon for all the work they did on bringing this volume together. It's great to have it done and to be having this conversation. So I'm going to share my screen and give a, this is basically, I'm going to summarize the content of my chapter, the argument of my chapter. It's, as you can see from the title, it's about value and life and how understanding life requires that we understand value and vice versa. So to start, my chapter poses this question: what is the most basic value aim, or you could say the most basic principle of life? Especially if we think that life is purposive, and we think that that's one of its features, what do we think that it is striving for or that it aims for? And most people think, at least in my experience, most scientists, most philosophers think that survival is really at the core, and that all value derives from this imperative. Thus, you could say that life creates value. And now that's a lot. I'm going to just unpack that a little bit. It's not always clear survival of what. Is it survival of an individual organism that is the imperative, survival of genes, survival of the species, or what have you? And that's not always clear. Also, the imperative of survival, from a Darwinian perspective or a neo-Darwinian perspective, is something imposed at the population level, especially if we're talking according to Malthusian principles. And so just because there is a selection on a population that imposes this sort of criterion of survival of the fittest, that doesn't mean that the individuals being selected themselves value in any sense survival or what is, so to speak, valued by the selection process. Nevertheless, despite all of that, people do seem to have this notion that somehow organisms internalize this imperative of survival, such that every organism is, in a sense, driven by this basic aim to survive. Although that's not explained scientifically. There is no scientific explanation of any kind of motivation whatsoever at any level of life, at least not that I know of. But it's somehow assumed that insofar as there is any kind of basic motive in life, it must be for survival or self-preservation or self-maintenance or what have you. And so a lot of what I'm going to talk about is basically an attempt to rethink life from a different premise that is not this one, right? Not this standard perspective, yet a different one, which is very much taken from Whitehead. And I should emphasize at the outset that what I do in this chapter is not present a theory of life. It's really far short of that. If you've ever read about the workings of, you know, even the simplest examples that everybody agrees on as living, which would be bacteria. There might be things simpler than that, but everybody agrees that bacteria are alive. Well, they're just mind-bogglingly complex. And that is a lot to try to understand the emergence of and so forth. And I don't get into any of those details, but I do think that, you know, all across the biological sciences, this basic notion that life is really about survival, and that if there is such a thing as value in the natural world, it comes from that. It comes from survival. And that's what I mean by life creates value. That is, I think, a very widespread presupposition. I read a scientific paper by a scientist just yesterday that flatly declared this as much. So what is it like to think about life from a different perspective? That's basically all this chapter is about. So Whitehead said that in fact, life is comparatively deficient in survival value. And I think that's from Function of Reason. And he pointed out that if survival is what you want, then a lot of inorganic entities do a lot better job of it, right? And he also pointed out that just persisting, just maintaining one's the form of an organism is not what we see most organisms trying to do. And he talks of a threefold urge of life. And one is to live, second to live well, and third to live better, that is to flourish. And I think that that is an intuition that a lot of us have, is that you can say of living things that they can flourish, not just survive. And yet it's a lot of people say you cannot say those of inorganic processes, even though some of them are able to survive and maintain themselves for very long periods of time. So life seems to suggest to us a different concept of value that's not based on survival, but what is that and where does it come from and how does it help us understand life? So basic thesis of my chapter that I explore in very broad brush form is that a value is in fact more fundamental than life, and that the pursuit of value creates life. So as you can see, that's kind of a reversal of the more common premise that life creates value. So just again, to emphasize the unusual nature of Whitehead's perspective on value, there are generally four, I would say, this is just one way to categorize them and it's very rough, but there are four different ways you could say of understanding value nature. One is that value is not really real. It may be a part of our experience, but a proper scientific understanding of value will reduce it to something that is not value. And that's effectively saying that value is illusory. Others may believe that value is a real and irreducible feature of human experience, but they suspect that there is no such thing as value beyond human experience. Many, actually, an increasingly large group, believe that value is somehow inherent to life, And this maybe has something to do with what I was saying earlier about this concept of life as being mostly about persistence or survival. And they would say that some kind of normativity of value is implicit in that imperative of survival. And so it's inherent to life, but not a part of the inorganic world. And lastly, there are some who hold that value is inherent to existence or being itself. Now, I believe that Whitehead held the fourth view. He thought that value was extremely important to understanding concrete actuality as such. And I'll talk a little bit about that now. But just more generally, I want to point out this vague presupposition of modern thought, which is that value is somehow bounded within the world. We're not very clear about where to draw that boundary, about what it has value or is driven by value and what does not. But I think it's very widespread, the presupposition that somewhere in nature, there's a transition for things that do not have value or do not sense or aim at value and things that do. And that's, I would say, I'm not sure what the percentage would be, but overwhelming majority of scientists and philosophers assume that. So as I mentioned earlier, Whitehead's aesthetic approach to reality involves putting value back into nature in a fairly radical way that is maybe unique in Western thought in the period in which Whitehead was writing. I'm not sure about that, but I don't know of any other who goes so far as he does. So quality, feeling, value, all of these things that are left out of the abstractions of modern scientific explanation, these are all essential to Whitehead's aesthetic approach to recovering the concreteness of reality. But also, and this is what I'll talk a little bit about in a bit, they're also essential to understanding the origins of the abstract patterns described by science. So, you know, a lot of people will describe Whitehead as a panpsychist of some kind. I know that term is not always popular with Whiteheadians. You could just as well describe him as a pan-value theorist, a pan-axiologist. I don't know what the word would be, but he's pan a lot of things, pan qualities, those kinds of things. But if you look at panpsychism in, say, analytic philosophy of mind right now, it's profoundly different because the way they're approaching it is more along the lines of these are special properties of our experience that we don't know how to place within the natural world. And that's this problem of mind and nature and the gap and so forth. And Whitehead was concerned about that. But his theory, his understanding of quality, feeling, and value was not that they were just special properties that needed a place in the natural world. He understood them, as I say here, they're essential to understanding the concreteness of reality. So as you know, in the processual view, every occasion is a perspective on this vast multiplicity, and it has to bring that to unity. And quality, feeling, and value all play a role in that production of a concrete individual experience. And the role of value is just as important as any other feature. It's the aim of unification, aside from unification itself, that is. It is the primary aim. Whitehead's concept of value is a harmonic concept of value, which means that it has to do with bringing things together. That has to do with the unification of multiplicity. Now, in my experience, most people, when they think about harmonic values as they apply to multiplicities, they usually focus on compatibility, meaning how can you get lots of different things to coexist together and to be unified in that way. But Whitehead called that the first order of harmonic beauty. And for Whitehead, actually going beyond that is something that he used the word contrast, and which is to say that more than just compatibility, we speak that unification involves at some level some intensification of the differences, but also the individualities of the components in feeling. You might think of this in terms of like cooking. When you bring together lots of different ingredients into a dish, what you want to do is to bring out certain flavors and ideally have them enhance one another in some complementary fashion. And that's in a sense, that is contrast. I put some examples here that come from color, which is where we observe contrast most easily. You might say that the figure on the left, the strong contrast of yellow and purple, is the most intense contrast. But in Whitehead's thought, intensity actually always includes the element of diversity as well. It's not just strength of contrast or forcefulness, but also diversity of components. And so for Whitehead, the figure with the most contrast or intensity, so to speak, would be the one in the middle, because you have clearly individuated different colors, but not just two, but multiple ones. And that's sometimes a misleading aspect of his use of the word intensity. People think of something more like the figure on the left, which obviously is intense. I'm not saying it's not, but it doesn't have that figure, that component of diversity, which is what I think Whitehead meant by intense experience. What Whitehead said in his cosmology is that every entity, every actual entity in its coming into being and its self-creativity aims not just at unification, but at intense feeling, intense experience through that unification. And that is what gives rise to all the order that we observe around us. And that is a very radical thesis. And it's not just about life, but it has very important implications for understanding of the emergence of life and what life is. So I just want to talk about how this aim at intensity works, this as an explanation of the origin of order. So the origin of order is a special explanatory challenge in science that's often not realized as such. A lot of science in normal science, and this is not necessarily a bad thing, it works by explaining some kinds of order with reference to other kinds of order. And that works very well in lots of limited contexts. But when you start asking more questions, either you get to an infinite regress of order explaining order, or you get to some claim that some kinds of order in the universe are somehow fundamental and cannot be explained. What you don't get is an explanation of why this order and not another. I think I've just gone over what some of the limitations can be of using order to explain order. Another one is that these are dealing with abstractions when you're explaining one pattern of order in terms of another. The aim at intensity or value offers a different kind of explanation. And Whitehead said at one point in Modes of Thought that all ultimate reasons are in terms of an aim at value. Again, I just want to point out how radical that claim is in the context of modern cosmology. So just to clarify, order is not the same as value. So an aim at value is not an aim at order per se. Rather, order is a factor in the production of value. Also, I sometimes in my own speaking just now, I go back and forth between intensity and value, strictly speaking, I think intensity refers to the subjective aspect of value. It is value enjoyed by the occasion itself and its own sort of self-creativity. But that achievement of intensity for itself then becomes a value to be taken up by others and enter into their experience as well. So there's an objective side to it as well. Again, the basic claim here is that order exists and is perpetuated and it grows and complexifies, but also deteriorates insofar as it contributes to intense feeling. So intensity governs what happens to order, either its increase or its decrease. And just to clarify also, there are two kinds of order that we're interested in right now. One is the kind that pertains to a single occasion, which is the form that it adopts to reduce multiplicity to unity and thereby to achieve intensity. But then there's another form of order, which was what I believe Philip was talking about in his talk, which is the recurrence of pattern or the recurrence of form. But the thesis here is that both kinds are ultimately explained by the aim at intensity. This means that the emergence, growth, persistence, and deterioration of order in the second kind is always governed by, in some sense, the aim at intensity. That is the ultimate explanation for it. A way to sort of to get your head around this idea I found helpful is to sort of think of occasions, and this is not quite right, and I'm sure those of you that know Whitehead can point out its inadequacies, but just for as a heuristic, to think of occasions as being sort of moments of immediate gratification. So they aim at maximum intensity in their own self-creativity. And that immediate gratification can be with respect to order, can have many different consequences depending on the social context of that occasion. So immediate gratification in some contexts can mean repeating the pattern that is around that occasion in its locality, right? And basically not changing it that much because that's the kind of intensity that is available for it. In other cases, it can be it can mean radical departure, something very new. In other cases, it might mean a deterioration, something that is ultimately destructive for its environment. And so, the aim at intensity can have very different consequences for order, and that is what makes it so interesting as a way of understanding the emergence of life, but you know also other kinds of enduring entities. So very different kinds of enduring existence, living and unliving, can emerge from the same fundamental aim. That is what is so interesting here. And that's what Whitehead offers us to think with, is this idea. Okay. So a Whiteheadian philosophy of life. Then again, I'm not offering here a complete theory, just a different perspective. How is life distinguished then in Whiteheadian perspective? And one of the things that is sometimes missed when Whitehead's philosophy is discussed, like for instance, panpsychism, sometimes assumed to mean that consciousness is everywhere, but of course, Whitehead had a way of distinguishing consciousness from other kinds of experience. And Whitehead also, in many parts, you know, does claim that there is an aspect of life which is ubiquitous, but he also had ways of, he offered ways of trying to distinguish between living systems and non-living. And living systems, even if it's a distinction of degree, they would be distinguished one by higher grade intensity of feeling, principally through the incorporation of novelty. I think that's the theory that he suggests in Process and Reality. Now, all occasions incorporate novelty into their feeling. But in the case of living ones, that incorporation of novelty is much more prominent and important in many low-grade occasions, I guess you might say, in organic systems, whatever novelty there is from moment to moment is trivial and does not alter the overall pattern. Whereas, of course, we know that in living systems, there is persistence through constant changes of form. And this was something that was commented on at length in the previous chapter. Life, one of the things that's very hard to explain about life is its constant changes of form. And this is the case, not just in the case of metamorphosis, but as was pointed out, any kind of behavior is a transformation of form that is guided by the organism. But also growth is a change of form. So it's possible to say that change of form is basic to life and requires a special theory to understand how that is done. And also, Whitehead says that living entities are very complex systems directed by what he calls a regnant core of maximum vitality. This may be more the case in some organisms like animals than in plants, but even at the individual cell level, you might say that there is somehow a dynamic core of maximum vitality or intensity of feeling that somehow governs and holds together the processes of that entity. So just in conclusion, very briefly, again, I want to say that this is not a complete theory, a perspective, but it is one that starts, as I pointed out, from radically different premises about the relationship of value and life. It has certain advantages, I would say, in comparison with standard perspective that makes self-maintenance or survival the central principle. One of them is that Whitehead in perspective is able to register the importance of self-preservation. It's not that we need deny that this is a basic and extremely important characteristic of life, the capacity for self-preservation. But so also is death. And when self-preservation is just made to be the basis and the core, then unless you're more specific about what is surviving, and some biologists are in a way that seems to account for death, then you can't really account for death, especially if continuance is the most basic value, then you can't account for the way in which death seems to be a natural part of life and not its total failure. But Whitehead is able to account for that with understanding something more like the aim at intensity as the governing principle. So just a couple of unfinished tasks that I think need to be fleshed out in this from this perspective on the way towards a more complete theory of life. One would be there needs to be a greater articulation of the transition between non-life and life. Now, obviously, it's not going to be, it's going to be some kind of discontinuity. And we can say that there are gradations, but what we see around us is that there is some kind of discontinuity between living and non-living things that needs to be understood. And all of the characteristics that I listed in the previous slide, they are continuous. They could vary continuously. And so with those characteristics alone, we don't quite have a theory of how life is so distinct from non-life. Also, I would say that something that I'm very personally very interested in is constructing a bridge between the Whiteheadian perspective and thermodynamics. So the energetic activity considered in physics is the emotional intensity entertained in life. That's something that Whitehead proposed at the end of Modes of Thought, pointing that was more or less how he was thinking about the matter. And a lot of work has been done since Whitehead on non-equilibrium systems and so forth, and how that might help bring in a different perspective on life has yet to be worked out, to my knowledge. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Nathaniel. You know, I appreciate your humility, but that you're not presenting a complete theory here, but you know, it's very much in the Whiteheadian spirit. I recall him saying in Process and Reality, when he's talking about the community of actual things, he says is an organism, in his more general sense of organism, but he says not a static organism, an incompletion in process of production. And so it would make sense in such a cosmos that all of our theories will also remain incomplete and in process of production. So as usual, there's so much more to talk about, but we have to draw this session to a close. Next Saturday, we will try to bring it all home. Spiridon and myself will be summarizing our chapters in this text, and we will have plenty of time for discussion with everyone else present. So I hope to see you there. Thanks so much to our panelists today. It was very, very nourishing and insightful. Always, though, opening up more questions than answers. Mm-hmm. So the conversation continues. Hope to see you all next weekend.